so very carefully performed. A film based in the heart of World War I, the story centers around the French military and the corruption that follows. A general of the French general staff orders a lower French general, General Moreau, to coordinate and initiate offensive on a German-defended position known as the Anhill. Initially, Moreau dissents the idea, claiming his men were in no shape for such an offensive. Moreau was bribed in the idea with the promise of a promotion, but pushes the duty onto a man under his command, Colonel Dax, under threat to relieve him of his duties if he does not comply. The attack on the anthill fails, leaving many of the 701st Regiment dead or wounded. General Moreau, disgusted with the attack, claims that men were not fighting hard enough, ordering friendly fire, which was refused, then vowing to have them executed. In the end, three men are selected and charged for cowardice, their sentence being death. Dax attempts to defend the men in court, only to be barred from any defense he raised. Ultimately, the three men are executed, and Colonel Dax offered General Moreau's command, though he refuses. The movie ends with the orders of the 701st Regiment being sent back into the front lines. This dramatic depiction of World War I is iconic for its painting of the disillusionment that comes with war and the corruption and glory drive that can result from the men who are not forced into the front lines. Colonel Dax is a symbol of the humanity in a mostly inhumane world, painted as a clear contrast to the men in command.
Well, now I know.
Based on the novel Johnny Got His Gun, also written by Dalton Trumbo, Joe is a soldier fighting in World War I when he is hit by a mortar shell, but is left with a fate worse than death. He is a quadruple amputee and has lost his eyes, ears, mouth, and nose, leaving him unable to communicate. Unbeknown to the doctors, Joe remains conscious and is able to think, but is unable to distinguish whether he is awake or dreaming. The film relives his life through his dreams and memories. Joe's new life has no meaning until he bonds with a nurse and he discovers a unique way to communicate with his caregivers. This dramatic anti-war film showed the psychological effects of warfare and became a reality during the time of the Vietnam War, when soldiers were coming home with extreme PTSD.
I could yell for help, but nobody'd help me. Not even God, because there isn't any God. Couldn't be in a place like this.
The film opens in 1941 with Colonel Hans landing inside of the Waffen SS, probably known as the Jew Hunter, visiting French Baron Dr. Perry Lapidite. In English, Landa notes that the papers state that all Jewish families are accounted for, except the Dreyfuses, who have vanished. After rambling on, he admits that he is required to conduct a thorough search of Lapidite's house. Landa manages to coerce Lapidite to get him to confess that he's hiding the Dreyfuses under the floorboards. On Landa's orders, soldiers fire the guns on the floorboards, killing the Dreyfuses. However, Landa hears noises and sees the teenage Susanna running away. Landa considers shooting her, besides against it. The second chapter takes place 3 years later, 1944, just prior to the Allied invasion of France. Lieutenant Aldo Rain is addressing his newly formed 8-man Jewish commando. He proceeds to explain to them that we'll be dropped behind enemy lines to cause havoc on all Nazi soldiers they come across. He further explains to them the normal standards of military crime will not apply, because the Nazis themselves have no humanity and they are not deserving of any humanity. Shazana has assumed the identity of Emmanuel Mimax and has become the proprietor of a cinema in downtown Paris, which is chosen by Frederick Zoller. Shazana realizes the presence of many high-ranking Nazi officials and obviously provides excellent opportunity for revenge. She decides to burn down the cinema.
We'll be that of an Apache resistance. We will be cruel to the Germans.
The Charlie Chaplin film, the story is a parody of Adolf Hitler's rise to power in the early stages of World War II. Beginning at the end of World War I, an unnamed soldier the audience comes to know as the Jewish Barber saves a pilot who claims to have the information that can result into mania, the fictitious Germany winning the war. To escape the enemy, the barber and the pilot, Commander Schultz, attempt to fly the plane back to Tamania to end the war. Unfortunately, the plane crashes, resulting in the barber losing his memory, and Commander Schultz is informed that the war has already ended and Tamania has lost. With the barber losing his memory, he does not recall the dictator Adolf Hitler's rise to power and returns to his barbershop, now in the heart of a Jewish ghetto. Schultz, now residing over the ghetto, orders that the Jewish barber and his neighbor girl, named Hannah, not to be harassed, only resulting in Schultz's command being rescinded due to being a democracy supporter, and Schultz along with the Jewish barber are sent to a concentration camp. The two escape from the camp, and the resemblance of the dictator and the barber made obvious to the audience, both men being played by Chaplin, where Hinkle is apprehended and sent to the camp in place of the barber, and the barber gives an inspirational speech calling for a better world free of dictatorships. Though it is comedic, this film was a social commentary of the times, calling for an end to the hate and an end to totalitarian regimes, valuing freedom and love and humanity above all, making this an important era film.
Here, take it.
Oh,
something's wrong.
Oh, oh, I can't reach it. Oh, water. Space. Oh, oh, it's all gone. What's the matter?
This belt is too tight.
Well, loosen it.
I'm trying to.
We're upside down.
I know it.
popular film emerging from the late 1990s, Saving Private Ryan is a film revisiting one of the most large-scale wars in history. This film follows the story of a group of Army Rangers tasked with finding and sending home Private James F. Ryan of the 101st Airborne Division after learning that his three brothers were all killed in action. This film centers around the brutality of war on the families back home, as well as the brutalities of war on the front line. The audience is teleported into a world of uncertainty and into the bloody reality that was World War II. As depicted in this film, everyone was just trying to find some good in a situation that seemed impossible. The men's lives on the line for not only defending their country and ideals, but also for the men they have next to them.
Please, Mr. President.
Moving into the Cold War era, this movie portrays a paranoid Air Force general believing that communists have fluoridated the American water supply. Launches a secret nuclear attack on the Soviet Union. Only he knows the code to recall the bombers and is completely unreachable with the Air Force. General Ripper's executive officer, Captain Lionel Mandrake, believes he may have cracked the recall code, but has no way to get the message to the president with the Air Force base being on lockdown. Meanwhile, in the war room in Washington, President Muffley, General Turgidson, and a nuclear advisor slash former Nazi, Dr. Strangelove, are discussing measures to stop the attack on the Soviets and prevent a nuclear war. Unbeknownst to President Muffley, the Soviets have developed a doomsday device that will automatically detonate upon an attack.
Only the will
while the advisors in the war room try to solve their issue by talking to the Russian premier, Major T.J. King Kong, a B-52 bomber pilot, is fulfilling his duty of dropping the bomb by any means necessary.
It is not only
Major King ultimately succeeds and sets off the doomsday device and plunges the world into an apocalypse before Dr.
Deterrence is the art of producing in the mind of the enemy the fear to attack. And so, because of the automated and irrevocable decision-making process which rules out human meddling, the doomsday machine is terrifying. It's simple to understand and completely credible and convincing.
Gee, I wish we had one of them doomsday machines, Stacy.
But this is fantastic.
It's the 60s during the Vietnam War at Paris Island, where a group of young Marine recruits are being prepped for basic training by Gunnery Sergeant Hartman, whose orders are to weed out all the non-hackers. Hartman gives each recruit a nickname, one being Joker, the other being Cowboy, and one being Gilman Pyle, who Hartman throws his message of brutality on because of his overweight body and his inability to keep up with his teeth. Enraged, Hartman decides that from now on, instead of punishing Pyle, he'll punish all the other recruits in the platoon. A few nights later, the angry recruits attack Pyle with soap bars wrapped in towels beating him. After the experience, Pyle slowly begins to go insane, but also shapes up to become the fastest, best rifleman of his platoon. On the last night of the platoon, Joker Pyle draws Firewatch and finds Pyle in the bathroom with his gun fully loaded. He starts executing drill orders.
What do we get for $10?
And Hartman awakes to find him. He tells him to put the rifle down and shoots Hartman through the chest. Joker tries to calm him down, and Pyle agrees and nods and ends up shooting himself in the head, killing him. Lieutenant Hal Moore, a dedicated U.S. soldier, is deeply committed to training his troops who are prepping to be sent to Vietnam. Moore is dismayed because President Lyndon B. Johnson has decreed that the war would be fought on the cheap without declaring a national emergency. As a result, Moore believes he will be deprived of his oldest, best-trained soldiers. After arriving in Vietnam, he learns that an American base has been attacked. His order to take his 395 men after the enemy and eliminate them, despite the fact of intelligence and the number of enemy troops. He leads a new cavalry against 4,000 well-equipped enemy soldiers. Despite being trapped near the landing zone and desperately outnumbered, the main forces manages to hold off the enemy North Vietnamese with artillery, close air support, and even calling a last resort broken arrow airstrike at their most desperate time, killing most of their men, but also killing all the Vietnamese.
This next film is a testament to the brotherhood among military members following the quickly spiraling mission of a group of Army Rangers in the Somalian city of Mogadishu. These men are given the task of capturing the self-proclaimed president of Mogadishu's two advisors, though shortly into this mission, the first Black Hawk helicopter of two is shot down. Quickly, the mission turns from capturing the two advisors to evacuating and minimizing casualties, while making sure that, as the tagline of the film says, no man is left behind. The importance of this film derives from the brotherhood depicted in the film, vocalized by one of the experienced members of the mission, stating that it's about the men next to you and that's it. It's all it is.
Fight somebody else's war. What do y'all think, you're heroes? I didn't know what to say at the time, but if you asked me again, I'd say no. I'd say there's no way in hell. Because nobody asks to be a hero. It just sometimes turns out that way. I'm gonna talk to your mom and pa when I get home, okay?
our last movie moves into the Iraq War. Based on the personal wartime journal of Mark Bold, The Hurt Locker portrays the conflict in the Middle East from the point of view of a group of soldiers. When Sergeant First Class William James joins Bravo Company in Iraq, they are in their last month of their tour. The company are bomb experts, and James is sent in to replace a veteran member of the team that was killed defusing an explosive site. While James is great at what he does, he is obsessed with capturing an adrenaline high each time he defuses a bomb. He even keeps account of every bomb he has defused. James' squad member, Sergeant J.T. Sanborn, and Specialist Owen Eldridge are just trying to survive the last days of their duty, but James plunges them headfirst into chaos and danger while he himself is indifferent to death. The Hurt Locker shows soldiers' psychological reactions to the stress of war, which is unbearable to some, but addictive to others.
We're done! Sanborn! Let's get out of here!